السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome back. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. All praise be to Allah alone. We all praise Him and we seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is the truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, none can show him guidance. I bear witness that there is no God worthy of worship but Allah alone, and I bear witness that Muhammad, peace be upon him, is his last messenger. Brothers and sisters, welcome to the 7th edition in our program, Treasures from the Cave. In the previous episode, we barely scratched the surface and we started the main story of Surah Al-Kahf, the sleepers of the cave. We discussed ayah number 9 and ayah number 10, and we learned that Allah the Almighty stated that the story of the sleepers of the cave is amazing, but it is not more amazing than the creation of the heavens and the earth. Then in the following ayah, which is basically, I'd like to jump into ayah number 13. In ayah number 13, Allah the Almighty says, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ نَبَأَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ وَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدًى. نَحْنُ, the royal we narrate unto you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, their story in truth. So what is their story? إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ. فِتْيَةٌ, they were youth. They were youth. They were youth because, in fact, as it has been stated in many stories and ayat, that most of those who believe are the youth. And most of those who oppose the message of all the prophets were the elders and the chieftains. So the youth have been admired for their willingness to accept faith. And most of those who followed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the beginning were the youth, while most of those who opposed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were the elders of Mecca, whether in Mecca or in Medina. إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ. They believed in the Lord. Then Allah the Almighty says in Surah Al-Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 60, قالوا سمعنا فتى يذكرهم يقال له إبراهيم. Ibrahim عليه السلام at this age was, you know, grown up, but he was still a youth. So Allah the Almighty described him as fatan, youth, this young man. And all the prophets have been appointed with the prophethood at the age of 40, which is the best of the lifespan of any individual. It is the age of the strength. وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِفَتَاهُ in Surah Al-Kahf, it will come. Number 60, chapter number 18. Remember when Moses said to his fatah, the young man who used to assist Musa alayhi salam, was Yusha ibn Nun, whom we will learn about his story insha'Allah, who succeeded Prophet Moses, peace be upon him, and he accompanied him in the journey of learning from Al-Khadr, peace be upon them all. So Allah the Almighty says, إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ وَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدَى, and we increased them in guidance. So they took the initiative. They believed in the Lord. They believed in the oneness of Allah the Almighty. They believed truly in their Creator, in His Lordship, in His unity of everything. So as a result, when they took the initiative and they believed in Allah the Almighty, Allah the Almighty increased them in guidance. آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ وَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدَى, and we increased them in guidance. This ayah, brothers and sisters, ayah number 14, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ نَبَأَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ وَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدَى. This ayah is a reference to a fact that the mainstream of this ummah, Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, believe in, which is the concept of the increase and the decrease of one's iman. Yes, we do believe that al-imanu yazidu wa yanqus. Faith increases and it can decrease. What increases the iman? And what decreases the iman? And what made us believe so? We believe so because here is an ayah number 13. Allah the Almighty says, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ نَبَأَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ. We narrate unto you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, their story with the truth. إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ وَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدَى. They were young men who believed in the Lord and we increased them in guidance. That is not the only reference though. In Surah Muhammad, chapter number 47, verse number 17, Allah the Almighty says, وَالَّذِينَ اهْتَدَوْا زَادَهُمْ هُدًى وَآتَاهُمْ تَقْوَاهُمْ. As for those who have been rightly guided, Allah increased them in guidance and gave them, granted them their righteousness. زَادَهُمْ هُدًى. So al-Iman is not something that settles at a certain level and it does not get affected, no, it fluctuates. It can increase, it can get very high, and it can decrease, and it can get very low. Another indication to that is in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَا يَزْنِي الزَّانِي حِينَ يَزْنِي وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنِ وَلَا يَسْرِقُ السَّارِقُ حِينَ يَسْرِقُ وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنِ وَلَا يَشْرَبُ الْخَمْرَ حِينَ يَشْرَبُهَا وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنِ. Which means whenever a Muslim or a believer indulges into any of these major sins, at the time of committing these sins, he mentioned the first sin, adultery. Whenever a person commits adultery, he is not a mu'min. It doesn't mean that he's a kafir. It means that his iman is very low. And that's why it did not provide him with the protection against indulging into adultery. And whenever a thief commits theft, his iman is very low, that it does not help him out to hinder, refrain from stealing. And whenever a Muslim drinks, it happens. That's a sign that his iman is very low. That's why most likely you will find the people who are involved in these major sins do not pray, they do not fast, so they do not make up, they do not do any effort in order to increase the level of their iman. That's why they are easy hunts for Satan, because they don't have immunity. They are very weak. Also, Allah the Almighty says in Surah At-Tawbah, verse number 124, chapter number 9, Surah At-Tawbah, repentance. He says, فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فَزَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَهُمْ يَسْتَبْشِرُونَ. As for those who believed, our verses will increase them in iman. And they will rejoice whenever Allah the Almighty reveals new verses. Why? Because al-iman yazidu bil-ta'ah wa yanqusu bil-ma'asiyah. One's faith increases simply as a result of doing good deeds. Whenever you pray, your iman increases. Whenever you give any charity, the level of your iman will go higher. Whenever you offer nawafil, the level of your iman will jump to the highest level. Whenever you do i'tikaf, whenever you have tendency to commit a sin, then you refrain from committing the sin. That also will boost your iman and will increase your iman. In Surah Al-Fath, chapter number 48, ayah number 4, Allah the Almighty says, لِيَزْدَادُوا إِيمَانًا مَعَ إِيمَانِهِمْ. And in order for them to get increased in their iman. So they already have iman. They are already believers. And that will raise the level of their iman. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ الْإِيمَانَ لَيَخْلِقُ فِي جَوْفِ أَحَدِكُمْ كَمَا يَخْلِقُ الثَّوْبِ فَاسْأَلُوا اللَّهَ أن يجدد الإيمان في قلوبكم. إيمان, what is the source of faith? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in many ahadith referred to this organ, to this body part which is the heart, as the source of intention, as the source of faith. He said, in everybody there is a morsel of flesh. If this is healthy, then the entire body is healthy. If it is corrupt, then the entire body is corrupt and ruined. It is the heart. We're gonna take a short break and we'll be back inshallah with some more. Please stay tuned.
If I were to ask you about the life of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, about the incidents that occurred before his prophethood and in Mecca and in Medina, about the names of his loved ones and his wives and his children, how much would we be able to know? How many incidents have we memorized? Brothers and sisters, isn't it more important that we study the seerah of the most important human being who ever walked the face of this earth? Join me, your host Yasir Qadhi, as we discuss the most important biography of the most illustrious human being that ever lived, the seerah of our beloved Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Join Yasir Qadhi in Seerah of the Prophet, peace be upon him, every Monday at 3:30 p.m. and repeat telecast at 2 a.m. India on Peace TV.
Where truth is hidden, misleading quotations create confusion. Where truth is hidden, lack of knowledge and wisdom cause upheaval and commotion. Where truth is hidden, manipulated scriptures and twisted facts emerge. This very hidden truth creates false propaganda, mayhem, chaos, disorder, and turmoil in our lives and the world order. But is there anyone with courage and wisdom? What is the truth, and who has the courage to expose it? Because it's your right to know the truth.
Watch Truth Prevail and Lies Perish in Truth Exposed by Dr. Zakir Naik, next on Peace TV.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. Brothers and sisters, we've been speaking about the concept of wazidnahum huda. Allah the Almighty said in ayah number 13, and we increase them in guidance because they have chose to be rightly guided, so increase them in guidance. And we provided ayat and ahadith with reference to the concept of increasing the iman and the possibility of increasing and decreasing also the iman of the believer. Abu Darda, may Allah be pleased with him, a great companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, min fiqh al-abdi, أن يعلم أمزداد هو أو منتقص. A sign of being a fahim, a person who understands his deen, a person who is blessed, one of the signs of being comprehending your deen is to realize whether your iman is increasing or decreasing. As we say that there are many good means that increase the iman. Basically, doing any good deed, doing any ta'a, الإيمان يزيد بالطاعة. And on the other hand, it decreases simply due to sinning, either by indulging into sins or by not doing the acts of ta'a. May Allah guide us to what is best. With regards to those youth and their time and their place, we will find in many narrations they were at this city and they would give a name to the city and they would give a name to the cave and they will make an effort to find the name of the youth who were in the cave. But guess what? Allah Almighty did not keep us busy with any of that. He said, إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ Ayah number 13. They were youth who believed in the Lord, and that's it. It doesn't matter whether we know their names or not. And it doesn't matter whether we know their city or not. Even if we know where is their cave, what are we going to do with it? Unfortunately, many people keep us busy and keep the seekers of knowledge and the layman busy with some very details that would not benefit whatsoever, such as the name of their dog, because they used to have a dog with them. It's mentioned in the Quran, but it doesn't say the dog was a male or a female. And what is the name of the dog? It doesn't mention. It doesn't mention the city. It doesn't mention the name of the people. But whether they were following the faith of Prophet Jesus or the faith of Prophet Moses, there is a difference of opinion between the scholars. Some say that they were following Christianity, but others objected to that and they said, wait a minute, how did the people of the book, the Jews, learn about their story and it is mentioned in their scripture? If the story of the sleepers of the cave came way after them, because in order for them to be Christians, that means they came after Jesus, peace be upon him. So the more right view that the incident of the sleepers of the cave took place before Jesus, peace be upon him, because the Jewish rabbis have memorized this story. Abdullah ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, mentioned that they lived in a kingdom where the king was a tyrant king who forced his people to worship idols. And when they realized that there is no way that they can remain in their kingdom as believers, they decided to skip living in the city and to flee. And when they met each other on the way, on the borders, in the desert, they got to know each other. And with extreme care, they started speaking to each other about faith. And when they realized that they were all believers and on the same page, they decided to take a shelter in the cave and take refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this cave, in which Allah the Almighty made it an amazing story for them and recited it in the Quran to be recited until the day of judgment. They insisted on Tawheed. The historians and the Mufassirin said that these youth were not ordinary people. They belonged to the high society. They were rich people. But they gave up on all of that for the sake of their belief. They did not give precedence to living a lavish life and a luxurious life over their belief and their faith. They totally refused the idea of associating others with Allah the Almighty. In fact, those who do worship the idols, whether those people and their king, the town and the kingdom of the sleepers of the cave, or the people of Mecca, they believed in God, but they associated with him the idols. And these idols were images of righteous people whom when they died, that Satan made it seem fair to them, let's make some images in order to commemorate the remembrance, so that in order to remember them occasionally, so that we can follow their footsteps. And gradually, they ended up worshiping them, generations after generations. Satan is very patient. He is not in a hurry. But by the end, he achieved his goal, where he ended up making people lose their sense and their common sense, and they ended up worshiping stones, which they carved by their own hands. So there is a similarity between the story of the sleepers of the cave, the same circumstances that they were living in this kingdom, in which the king have ordered his people to worship these idols, and the people of Mecca, in which the Meccan chiefs insisted on opposing the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah the Almighty says in Surah Luqman, chapter number 31, in the 25th verse, Allah the Almighty says, وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُم مَّنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهُ. O Muhammad, if you were to ask them, who created the heavens and the earth, they will say, Allah. Then in Surah Az-Zumar, chapter number 39, in the third ayah, Allah the Almighty says, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. These ayat and this story have been narrated in order to warn us not to slip into the same pit, not to fall into the same error, brothers and sisters. Idols do not necessarily have to be in the form of statues, but there are a lot of varieties of idols. A person who's wearing a talisman in around his wrist. A woman who's wearing a necklace and she's using it as a talisman, a man or a woman. A person who's keeping an amulet in his pocket or in his glove compartment or from hanging from his front mirror because somebody told him that as long as you keep this, it will provide you with protection. You will never get in a car accident and you will never be hit with an evil eye. This is a form of associating others with Allah in worship. These stories and these ayat were not narrated so that we enjoy listening to a tale or a fairy tale or a bedtime story. This is to warn us that Satan does not take the believers into disbelief all of a sudden. But Allah the Almighty rather says in the Quran, لا تتبعوا خطوات الشيطان. All you who believe, do not follow the footsteps of Satan. We do not see Satan, let alone seeing his footsteps. But we know that Satan does not take people from belief into the pen of disbelief all of a sudden. Rather, he gradually withdraws them. For instance, when he makes a person who prays, a person who fasts, a person who believes in Allah, wears an amulet, who believes in certain ta'weez, or talisman that ruins all his prayers. When a Muslim who prays visits a soothsayer, a fortune teller, or a sorcerer, if he believes in him, he has disbelieved in Allah. He has disbelieved in the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And if the person says, I'm just checking it out, his prayer will not be accepted. In addition to, this is just one step in the wrong direction. It will take your spouse. The first time you go to visit him, to find out about a lost item, or to make somebody love somebody else, or to create love between a couple. All of that is absolutely forbidden, and these are all acts of associating others with Allah in worship. Remember, ayah number 3 of Surah Az-Zumar. وَالَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. Those who have taken besides Allah, awliya, they have taken them as supporters, they have taken them as, this is their claim. They said, مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. We only worship them and we take them as means of approach. Yeah, we believe in God. And if you were to ask them who created the heavens and the earth, they innocently answer saying, Allah. And if you ask them who created them, they would answer, Allah. Who created the sun and the moon? Allah. So what about these idols? ما نعبدهم إلا ليقربونا إلى الله زلفا. We're not good enough to communicate with Allah directly. So we communicate with Allah through the intermediaries, the idols. What is these idols? Oh, these are for the images of righteous people who died. Guess what? Many Muslims today are doing the same. I have seen by my own eyes, I've seen by my very eyes, people who have built piers or tombs inside the masjid where they buried a person whom they say he's righteous. Whether he's righteous or not, no one knows other than Allah the Almighty. And whether he's righteous or not, it will not legitimize this act because the Prophet ﷺ forbade that entirely. Or they would come on the grave of a righteous person as they believe. And again, as I said, it will not make any difference whether he's righteous or not. It will not change the ruling. And then they will build a musalla or a tomb so that people start going to pray there. And meanwhile, seeking the blessings from the dead person, from his tomb, offering their gifts to the dead person. Obviously, all of that will be collected by the custodians who would encourage people to disbelieve in Allah as long as it is making them gain financial interest. So that's why, brothers and sisters, we have to reflect on the story of the sleepers of the cave, that they have abandoned the whole dunya and they fled from what? From worshiping the idols, and they blame their own people for worshiping other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they said, لَوْلَا يَأْتُونَ عَلَيْهِ بِسُلْطَانٍ بَيِّنٍ. Why don't they bring a proof or an authority that we should worship these idols? They don't have any proof. Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he destroyed the idols in the temple, then when the people returned and they found all the idols were demolished except for one, they said, سَمِعْنَا فَتًا يَذْكُرُهُمْ يُقَالُ لَهُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ. We heard a person who used to speak ill about our gods. His name is Ibrahim. So they brought him and they questioned him. And they said, أَأَنْتَ فَعَلْتَ هَذَا بِآلِهَتِنَا يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ. It's an ayah of the Quran. Did you do that to our gods? He said, me? No. فَاسْأَلُوهُمْ إِن كَانُوا يَنْطِقُونَ. بَلْ فَعَلَهُ كَبِيرُهُمْ. I think this big one, because when Ibrahim a.s. destroyed the idols, he placed the axe in the shoulder of the remaining idol. And he said, بَلْ فَعَلَهُ كَبِيرُهُمْ. It was the biggest. This idol, whom you call it God, is the one who destroyed the rest of the idols. فَاسْأَلُوهُمْ إِن كَانُوا يَنْطِقُونَ. Why don't you ask them if they are able to speak? So he actually humiliated them because they realized that even if they ask them forever, even if they sit next to them until the day of judgment, they will neither understand their questions nor will they be able to answer. So that's why they said, لَوْلَا يَأْتُونَ عَلَيْهِمْ بِسُلْطَانٍ بَيِّنٍ. Brothers and sisters, we have just come to the end of this edition of our program. Until next time, I leave you in the protection and the guidance of Allah the Almighty. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Ooh.